Kat Kerr is a mixed media artist whose work has appeared in many of the Stampington magazines as well as across various social media channels. Her style is always fresh, unique, and charming. I'm so happy to be able to share our latest collaborative effort of rubber stamps that feature interesting imagery and text. In today's video, I'll show you each of the designs as well as offer suggestions for stamping large images. Links to products can be found in the description down below. This initial release of Kat's rubber stamps includes 7 designs, several of which are larger sized and that create some really exciting design possibilities. So let me show you each of them. This one is named 3 Butterflies, and you can see several examples here. I'm back to using envelopes. They're on my workbench, and I reached for them because they were here and because I really enjoy working with them. So here are some examples. This one I did a border. Here you can just see it's the kind of the focal image on the tag and on the supersized ATC. And then here I stamped a repeat so it becomes this wonderful background, and kind of the same thing here, but a repeat done in an entirely different way. So the second item is named, or the second stamp is named Latin, and if you look, that's what all of this is. Now again, it's on an envelope. It's a big stamp, so let me bring this stamp in to show you, and you can see that it is a big stamp full of text, and that's what you see here. Again, this, because it measures about 6x6 for something like one of our 6x6 disc bound journal pages, one impression is going to fill your background, so it's quick and easy. And then this one is actually, you can see the word Namaste here, which is not part of the Latin, but there is a stamp that's named Namaste, and I've combined these to create this kind of overall background. Now you're going to see Namaste or parts of it here, and you're going to see another part a little bit further along. But before I get too far out of order, this sample is named Queenie. Now this is a 2-piece stamp. You can set this a crown above her head at whatever distance you want. You cannot use it and give her an entirely different crown if you want. But she's got this lovely face with wings, and I've come in with some Starform stickers. This is a kind of a flocked velvet that you can actually feel, and then the others are glittery. And there, because I can, there's some stickles on here too. So this is named Seeker Girl. Now the interesting thing about this stamp is that you don't have to use it in its entirety. You can cut her out of the background, and I've got that for a little bit later on that I'll show you. Again, here's part of the text from Namaste. This is one of the, I can't think of the name of the, Passion Purple, I think, is what this envelope color is named. And if you look, you can see that there's oxides on the covers. I played and I was working with this, so this is an accordion style. This is a flip accordion style, depending on how you use it. But I thought that she was wonderful along with these colors on this cover. So this is named Be Brave. Let's pull this out of here. Is named Be Brave Frame. Now I've cut the background out. This is a 6x9 disc bound page. If I had another one in front of me, you could put, let me just grab this. You could put something behind it if you had something that you wanted to highlight in that frame. It could be a photo, it could be anything that you wanted to bring attention to. And here I did it on an envelope. Now I actually cut this one out too, so you can see this would be a really fun way to present somebody with a photograph. You could stick it inside of the envelope, glue it in place, and then you have this really easy way to display a picture, or you can use this to send to somebody. So then the last one is named Spread Your Wings. That's this here. And again, here's the top part of the Namaste stamp. Wonderful face again with the wings, and you can see that wings figure pretty heavily in here, whether it's butterfly wings, the wings on this, the wings here. I mean, there's lots of different wings in here. That seems to be a theme that Kat employed for this particular release. So while big stamps like these, so here's the Be Brave frame, and here's Latin. Well, these are not any more difficult to stamp than any other image, regardless of size. There are some things that you can do to make sure that you're going to get a good impression. So the first thing is to work with an ink pad that is not dried out. I say this every time I talk about stamping, but it is a really critical factor. The other thing is going to be the mount. Now I've got these on, this stamp measures 5x7, and I've got it on an 8x8 clear acrylic mount because that was the first thing that I grabbed that it fit on. We have clear acrylic mounts in a variety of sizes. This stamp measures approximately 6x6. It's on a 7x7 mount. You need to be able to pick this mount up and handle it without getting your fingers on the stamp. You need to be able to handle it confidently so that you're okay to go ahead and stamp. All right, So the other thing that you can do, whoops, wrong thing. The other thing that you can do is that even though these are cling mounted stamps and you can see the cling, that's what you see, that's the gray, it doesn't hurt to put a little pile of printer paper down. I find that that goes a long way again toward getting a good impression. So when you stamp, you can stamp directly onto the surface like I did here, or you can stamp on something else that you then plan on cutting out. And sometimes you color them, sometimes you don't. So this is Canson 90-pound watercolor paper. It's cold press, but it's reasonably smooth on both sides, and it's what it's my go-to. If I know I'm going to color a stamped image, this is what I want to use because the inks and all of those things work well on watercolor paper, which is meant to absorb water and do fun things with it. All right, so I'm going to ink this up, and I'm just going to take a second to get it well inked all the way around. Pretty good. So I'm going to bring in my watercolor paper, and I'm just going to turn it this way because I want to be certain that this is 8.5 by 11, the watercolor paper is 9 by 12. So I'm going to put this down, and I'm going to conserve paper because there's no point in wasting it, so I'll kind of push it toward one corner. And now I'm just going to come along, and I'm holding the mount and the stamp in place with my left hand, and then I'm using my right hand to go along and just make certain that I've applied pressure everywhere so that I know I'm going to get a good impression. I want to also make certain that I get in the middle. If you've got a little hump in your table, this is, or a little depression in your table, this is more often than not where my stamp seems to land, and then I don't get a good impression in the middle. Now obviously the very center of this is the empty oval, but I am just going to continue to press, and I'm not pressing super super hard, but I am pressing hard enough to make certain that I get that impression. So I'm going to pick this up, and there you go. Now, whether or not I choose to cut this out, or if I'd stamped it on a page like I did here, either way, obviously you want to center things as you need to. So when you stamp directly on the surface, you get this that you're going to, excuse me, when you stamp directly on the surface, you don't get this. In fact, what you get is something like this. So when you think about repeats, which is something that I really played with a lot this time, let's get this pad of paper out of the way. When you think about repeats, there's lots of different ways to do these things. You can make a border. You can fill an entire page. Now, how you set the repeat up doesn't make a darn bit of difference. You can do what I did, which is to alternate it. So you can see in three butterflies, let me find the stamp, it's here someplace. In three butterflies, the center butterfly is larger and the wings are different, and these two are a repeat. So if you find this larger center butterfly, you can see that I've got this offset so that when this was stamped, let's see where we are, this was stamped like this, and then the next one was offset a little bit, so it kind of creates this repeat that moves things just slightly. As I said earlier, when you have something as big as Latin and you're working on a 6x6 page like this is, or like I did on this example, one impression is going to get you a repeat on the background, but you can combine things. As I said a little earlier, this envelope, let's get this out of the way, this envelope combines Namaste, which is here, and which I stamped horizontally this way with Latin that I repeated. If I didn't tell you, you probably wouldn't know. But then when you look at the one that is just Latin, you can see that when you look at this, here are the envelopes arrayed the same way, but you can see that the text is going in different directions. So how you arrange, is if there is a position, if there's a correct position like there is with an envelope or with a page, how you align the words or the text or the image is entirely up to you. So on this one, again, I've kept these vertical, and when I created the border, well, where's that other green one? It's here someplace. I created a single border. Where is that white one? Here it is. Just a single stripe like this. There's nothing that says that I could not have run these horizontally instead. So we've talked about stamping overall patterns and background patterns. We've talked about creating borders. So what I'm going to do next is come back and I'm going to show you how I go ahead and I color images. Now let's look at stamping on watercolor and adding color, or in a couple of cases, not. So here on Queenie, you can see that aside from some stickles on the butterfly wings, and if I hold that up into the light, you can see the reflection, I chose not to add any color here. On this one, which is named Spread Your Wings, all I did was add some color to her cheeks. If I hold that, it's a little bit faded out in the, at least what I'm seeing in the camera, but I believe that you can see the pink that's on there. So how you choose to color or not these is entirely up to you, and they all have the option to use simply without any color at all, and they look just as good. Now, if all you want to do is add a little bit of color to the cheeks, so I've restamped Queenie here on some watercolor paper. That same 90-pound Canson. This is a Distress Oxide pad. The color is Victorian Velvet. You can use anything that you find suitable for the color of cheeks. So when I do this, I'm going to use my finger. And because I have a pretty small area, I'm actually going to use my pinky. I know that there are other kinds of applicators. For this particular look, I find the best thing I can do is use my finger, or like the side of my finger. And I want to use a light color so that I don't get this giant smudge when I first apply it. Now, if you're not certain what it's going to look like, just come up here and start to apply it, and you can see that I've got just that little bit of color smudged on there. So I'll come back and put some more color on. Now, thinking about, and I'm going to touch my face, which you can't see, but thinking about the placement of your cheeks, if you touch your cheeks, you realize that they kind of align, and again, I'm touching my own face, they align kind of with the corner of your eyes. So that's a help to decide where to place this pink color. So all I'm going to do is just very lightly apply some here. Now, I like to do this in tiny little steps, kind of like putting on blush, and I never wear makeup, but back in the day when I used to, you want to do it lightly so that you don't get too much on all at once. With your face, it's easy enough to take it off with soap and water. On this, not so much. So again, I want to get the kind of apple of her cheek placed correctly here. Now there's a smudge on there that I think is black or something that was on the paper beforehand, but honestly, that's all you have to do. And one of these cheeks is a little bit lower than the other because this is what happens when I work upside down. So do as I say, not as I do. And this really, this cheek should have been far closer up here. And I would obviously not use this stamp the way that it is unless there was a way that I could camouflage that somehow. But you'll want to think about that. So this one is a little bit too low. This one's a little bit too high. But you'll, again, you'll think about that when you go ahead and do this. So when you stamp with something like Stays On or Archival Black, which is what this is, it means that it's a permanent once it dries on that paper. Now, obviously, dry time with a solvent ink is going to be a little bit faster than with an oil-based ink like Archival, so you'll need to allow things to dry. But once this is dry, and let me find something else. Once this is dry, you can come in and add water-based products over the top, and you're not going to have any problem. So this is Latin sayings. This is the entire bulk of the stamp, stamped imaged a single time. But the cool thing here is that you don't have to use this as one big image. What you can do is cut it apart. So now you have a stamp that you can do all kinds of really interesting things with. So I'm just going to cut straight along here. Now keep in mind that I don't have to use, I'm going to this time, I don't have to use this as a block. I can simply use it and break these two lines of text up if I want. But for the ease of what I'm going to do, or for the demo of what I'm going to do here, I'm just going to leave it one big chunk like this. So watercolor paper accepts water. Well, duh, of course it does. So I have, this is Vibrant Turquoise from the Dylusions Ink Spray line. I'm just going to put a little bit out here. It's already been diluted, which is why it's in an unlabeled bottle. And I have a little bit of, this is Funky Fuchsia. So I'm going to put some of this out too, kind of over here. Now, this is probably more than I need because I'm going to thin these with a little bit of water. So I've got some water. I'm just going to spray it out here, and I'm going to put out enough because obviously when you have dry bristles and a brush, you need to get some water in there to absorb. All right, so now what I'm going to do is just lightly thin some of this color. It, you know, it's like adding salt when you're cooking, you know, and is there color in there? No, there's not. It's like adding salt when you're cooking. I was thinking there was leftover color in the brush. You can put it in, but you can't take it out. So once this gets too dark, it's going to be a lot harder to go ahead and lighten it if you put too much down. So I'm just liberally applying color here. Now I could kind of let this fade out as it moves to the bottom, or I could bring in a little bit of pink and let this kind of merge in the center as a little bit of an ombre. it forms a little bit of purple. So you can do something like that. So very effective, very simple. If I want to color something else, so for example, I have these butterflies. If I want the color to be a little bit darker, off to the side I have a piece of paper towel. So I just dabbed some of the excess water off of my brush so that I would get darker color. All I can do, or all I need to do really, now if I want to thin this as I move down, I can. It's just play. This is watercolor paper, so it's very forgiving, and it's going to help you as you go. Now, if I want some purple here, I can either grab some purple, or I can come back and I grab some of the turquoise color, and I can feather that in, and suddenly now I've got a little bit of a blue-purple thing going on. And butterflies, the patterns on butterflies are not so distinct that you can't monkey around a little bit and make this really anything that you want. So I don't know if I've got enough here to come back and go up here and put the color on up here, just maybe. So same kind of thing. This is really easy to do. Again, because it's watercolor paper, it's going to be pretty forgiving. Let's kind of make these match a little bit. So I don't have quite enough pink, which is why I'm getting more turquoise on this side instead of purple, but you get where I'm going. And of course, once you get this, once this dries, you can come back and you can add things like Stickles, or you can use liquid pearls or any of the dimensional type products. So as I said earlier, and let's just bring this in, when you have a design like this, well, it would help if I took the cutout one off. When you have a design like this, there's nothing that says you have to use it as a whole. So here is Seeker Girl, and she's simply set up by herself now. I've cut her away from the background. So if I want to make her dress kind of a bluish color, I can do that quite easily. These are kind of short sleeves, so they only come down so far. That was probably too far, but oh well. If I think that's too dark, I can come in and I can add a little bit of water. Her sleeve actually comes down to here. And I can just go ahead and fill in the color. Now when I do this, I tend to do this very loosely. I'm not looking for perfection by any stretch of the imagination. So you can see here that the color is not perfect. It doesn't blend perfectly, but that is not the way that I work. If you want to work that way, obviously it's a little bit different. So when we talk about not using the entire image, consider all of these things. Like I said, you can cut this out. Earlier you saw me show you the samples. Let's get this out of the way. You saw me show you the samples where I'd used Namaste, I pronounced that incorrectly. I used it in chunks. Even with the three butterflies, though these two are identical, you do get the second one here. Now, if I wanted to bring in Queenie, she might look nice with a butterfly up here someplace, or with Spread Your Wings, it's the same kind of thing. If I wanted to use one of these smaller butterflies, and nothing says that I couldn't put this on one of those little raised dimensional dots and lift this up so that there's some dimension. But super easy to work with. With all of these seven designs, there's more than one way that you can utilize the imagery, which I always think is a good thing. If you're going to buy something, the idea that you can get multiple uses out of it, I find very appealing. So these are Kat Kerr's seven new rubber stamps, debuting today here on YouTube, and of course over at the Joggles website.